everyone, good morning and welcome to BFC Live. As always, my name is Camden and it's so great to be online with you this morning, whether you're here for our 9 a.m. traditional worship or our 11 a.m. more contemporary style worship. It truly is so great to see you. If you're new with me this morning or have been coming to BFC for a little while and don't yet feel connected either to myself or the BFC community, I have one step I would love for you to do with me real quick. There's going to be a QR code that's going to swipe across the screen, and I want you to take out your phone and fill out this QR code. It's going to take you literally 2 minutes, and it's going to come right to my inbox so that I can learn more about you and get connected with you throughout the upcoming week. Another way that I would love to connect with you is tonight at our block party. We are meeting tonight as a BFC and Bethany, Oklahoma community here at our brand new Family Life Park. It's a wonderful space. You are going to want to see it. It is literally incredible. I cannot believe that we have the Family Life Park right here on our campus. We're going to meet together for a grand opening right at 5. We're meeting from 5 to 7 p.m., but we're going to have free hot dogs, community together. There's going to be an ice cream truck, I think a coffee truck. It's going to be an awesome night. We're just going to be together eating food, learning more about each other and having community together, and I would love to see you there so that I can meet you in person. We're over a screen right now, which is amazing. I love that we get to do this every Sunday morning, but I would also love to see you in person if you can make it tonight. We are on week 4 of Enemies of the Soul. We are going into enemy number 3, the world. We have been introduced so far to enemy number 1, the devil, and enemy number 2, the flesh. I know Pastor Rick has an awesome sermon prepared for us ahead as we wrap up our sermon series, Enemies of the Soul, in just a few minutes. Like I said, he's talking about the world today. What in the world is our enemy? How do we combat the world? How do we follow the way of Jesus and live our life to the fullest in him? Before we get started with that, though, we are going to worship together as a BFC community and watch our final BFC behind the scenes with our executive pastor, Misty Jagger. So let's go ahead and get started with worship today.
Strong when I am weak, when I'm standing in your presence. morning. You may be seated. Welcome to church today. My name is Ken. I'm one of our pastors here, and we are so glad that you are all here with us this morning to worship. If you are a guest that's worshiping with us for the first time, we are so thankful that you are here. We would love for the opportunity to get to know you and to get to meet you. In our lobby, there is a guest check-in desk. We have a gift for you, and we'd love to get to just tell you a little bit more about our church. We also love to connect with one another in community. And if you are someone who has attended our church for a while and you have something that you would like to talk with us, or you have anything that you would like to share with us, the best way to do that is to fill out a connection card. There's a connection card located in between each one of your seats underneath the armrest. We invite you to fill those out. If you're a brand new attender, we'd love for you to bring that card back to our guest check-in desk, but you can also drop them in the Give and Connect boxes that are in the back of our sanctuary. We would love to invite each and every one of you back to church this evening. From 5 to 7, we are having our block party that's in our brand new Family Life Park. We are going to get to open that up ceremonially for the first time. We've been having soccer games there, and it's been wonderful, but we'd love to just come and gather in community. There's going to be free food. There's going to be games, lots of opportunities to connect with one another, and then also our neighborhood members that we have invited to come and be a part of this event as well. So we encourage you, again, that's tonight at the Family Life Park from 5 to 7 p.m. Today is a special day here at BFC. This is a baptism Sunday. We get to celebrate. Yes, we can clap for that. Today we're celebrating 17 individuals who have made a commitment to Christ, and we are so excited for them. They're going to be baptized today. And so today, our very first candidate is Easton Tidrick. Easton said, "I've asked Jesus into my heart on September 15th. I'm thankful he forgives me of my sins. I want to help people believe in him just like Pastor Gabby, Pastor Allison, Miss Emily, my mom, and my E have helped me do as well." Easton Tidrick, you are baptized in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Easton, may you receive the grace and the healing of our Lord Jesus Christ, and may the power of the Holy Spirit work within you that you may be a faithful witness of Jesus. Amen. Next in the water is Elliot Heron. Elliot says, "I was about 5 years old when I asked Jesus into my heart in my room with my mom. She helped me because I did not know how. I thank Jesus for dying for my sin, for everything he does for me. I want to be kind and loving just like him." Elliot Heron, you are baptized in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Elliot, now receive the grace and the healing of our Lord Jesus Christ, and may the power of the Spirit work within you that you may become a faithful witness of Jesus Christ. Amen. Our next candidate is Samantha Matthews. Samantha says, "I asked Jesus into my heart during vacation Bible school in the sanctuary. I've learned about him through my grandparents who bring me to church, Pastor Allison and Pastor Gabby, and Pastor Rick when I get to go to big church. I want to be like Jesus by being kind to others and praying for my friends and my family." Samantha Matthews, this morning you are baptized in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Samantha, now receive the grace and the healing of our Lord Jesus Christ, and may the power of the Holy Spirit work within you that you may become a faithful witness of Jesus Christ. Amen. Our next candidate for baptism is Lucy Bergman. Lucy says, "At VBS this summer, I asked my dad to pray with me to invite Jesus into my heart and help me to live a better life. I pray that God will help me be kind, help others, and tell them about him." Lucy Bergman, you are baptized in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Lucy, now receive the grace and the healing of our Lord Jesus Christ. May the power of the Holy Spirit work within you that you may be a faithful witness of Jesus. Amen. Next in the water is Lennox Olson. Lennox says, I have attended church since I was very young. Recently, while talking with my dad, I asked Jesus into my heart. My family and pastors helped me learn about Jesus and being like him. I want to follow in his steps and love him the rest of my life. Lennox Olson, you are baptized in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Lennox, now receive the grace and the healing of our Lord Jesus Christ, and may the power of the Holy Spirit work within you that you may be a faithful witness of Jesus. Amen. Next into the water is August Hancock. August says, I came to know Jesus in second grade at Wednesday night church. I prayed at the altar and I asked Jesus into my heart, and it felt like a whole new world had opened up in me. When I talk to God, sometimes I say, please help me and my family that is not walking with you and guide them back to you. I thank God for my family just for being alive. I want to be like Jesus by being kind and caring to others. I want to be a servant to everyone. August Hancock, you are baptized in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. August, now receive the grace and the healing of our Lord Jesus Christ, and may the power of the Holy Spirit work within you that you may be a faithful witness of Jesus Christ. Amen. This next one is a special one for me. Next in the water is Trent Behrens. Trent says, I asked Jesus into my heart at the Good Friday experience at church. I prayed with my mom and my dad at the cross station, and then I took communion with Pastor Bricks. When I talk to God, I ask him to be with me and to keep me safe and help other people who need him. Trent Behrens, you are baptized in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Trent, may you receive the grace and the healing of our Lord Jesus Christ. May the power of the Holy Spirit work within you, that you may be a faithful witness of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Savior, because you healed my heart, you changed my name. celebrate some freedom today. Amen? Amen. Now entering the water is Josue Moreno. Josue says, I invited Christ into my life when I looked back at everything that has happened to me and my family and realized that Jesus had taken what was broken and brought restoration. I accepted Jesus as my Savior, leader, and guide, and I will continue to seek Him every day because He saw me first, and now I see Him. Josue Moreno, you are baptized in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Now receive the grace and the healing of our Lord Jesus Christ. And may the power of the Holy Spirit work within you that you may be a faithful witness of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Alexis Leal says, faith has always been a part of my life, from praying before cheer competitions to the Catholic upbringing that my dad gave me. But it wasn't until this year during one of my first SNU chapel services that I truly invited Jesus Christ into my life. I felt a sense of freedom I had never experienced before. I am closer to God than I have ever been, and am excited to continue this journey and see where God leads me. Alexis Leal, you are baptized in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Now receive the grace and healing of our Lord Jesus Christ. And may the power of the Holy Spirit work within you, that you may be a faithful witness of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Mary Beth Kessler says, I never really attended church growing up, but over the past year, I began to feel God's presence. I know He has always been there, but I didn't truly accept Him until I moved to SNU, a place where God has provided a place of belonging with new friends and my soccer family. God has grown my relationship with Him tremendously. He has led me to where I am supposed to be, the people I am supposed to meet, and He has shown me who I am and to be truly at peace. Mary Beth Kessler, you are baptized in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Now receive the grace and healing of our Lord Jesus Christ, and may the power of the Holy Spirit work within you, that you may be a faithful witness of Jesus forever. Amen. Trey Lee says, I learned about Jesus while growing up in the Salvation Army Church. At SNU, I met Pastor Tiffany and my friend Gavin, who helped me come to know Jesus personally. Going forward, I am trusting Jesus to guide me through life and to live according to His word. Trey Lee, you are baptized in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Now receive the grace and healing of our Lord Jesus Christ, and may the power of the Holy Spirit work within you, that you may be a faithful witness forever. Amen. Janeth Reyna says, I am getting baptized today because I love God and I believe Jesus Christ saves. I invited Christ into my life in 2020 when I realized that I was a sinner in need of a Savior. Jesus Christ accepted me for who I am and gave me a purpose in life to love and serve others just as Jesus did. I continue to follow God after my mother passed away because Jesus Christ brings hope through salvation. My relationship with God is going strong, and God is providing a way for me to answer His calling for my life to be a leader in the church, pray for others, and point others to Jesus. Janeth Reyna, you are baptized in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Now receive the grace and healing of our Lord Jesus Christ, and may the power of the Holy Spirit work within you, that you may be a faithful witness of Jesus. Amen. Amen. lives are changing. People are giving their lives to Jesus every day. And if that's a decision that you want to make today, you can still do that. If you want to be baptized today, you can still do that. During this next song, in this lobby, right over here, through these doors on this side of the sanctuary, there are pastors waiting to talk with you about what baptism is, and if you want to be baptized, they're willing to help you be baptized today at the end of service. Thank you.
Seated. Really good to celebrate baptisms this morning. Man, I just sat there and in my heart so grateful for everything that God is doing in everybody's life today. Somebody today maybe needs to hear this. We were in the car a lot of the day Tuesday, listened to a lot more news than usual. And it just seemed like everything was happening. They announced the port workers were going on strike, and what was that going to mean to getting supplies, and more missiles were launched at Israel, and the whole Russia-Ukrainian war doesn't seem to be coming to an end. We're in a heated election season, lots of divisiveness, a lot of concern for our nation. And then there's all these people from Florida to North Carolina who have experienced this flooding, and they're in need. Some are trapped, not able to get out of where they are, not enough food, not enough water. I just felt like the wheels were coming off. And in the midst of our world, God speaks to us through His Word. Psalm 46, God is our refuge. God is our strength. God is an ever-present help in times of trouble. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. And then the psalmist says, God says, be still and know that I am God. And I think maybe God's saying to somebody sitting in front of me this morning, you got a lot going on in your life. Maybe you feel a lot of concern about what's going on in the world. You walked in with something so heavy today that you wanted just to kind of say, God, please help me with this. And he's saying to you this morning, I see you. I know you. I hear you. Be still. I am God. I've got you. And so, Lord, I thank you in this moment for your word. I thank you that even if somebody has walked into this room this morning carrying something really heavy, they just felt your presence and they sensed that you are near and they know that you see them and that you love them and that you're at work in their situation. So I pray, Lord, that you express grace to them in this moment. Answer the deep prayers of their hearts and do something new in their life today. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hey, BFC, I'm Misty Jaggers, and I serve as our Executive Director of Staff and Family Ministries. Family Ministries at BFC includes all of our kids from birth through our high school seniors. Our Family Ministries team is committed to partnering with families to help their kids grow in faith. Today, I'm excited to serve as your host as we check out what happens on a Wednesday night at BFC in week 4 of Behind the Scenes. So here we go. I'm here on the second floor, which is home to our early childhood, elementary, and preteen ministries. Can you believe that on any given Wednesday night, we have over 130 kids on this floor alone? Each week, our kids get to participate in a worship service especially designed just for them. And not only do they get to worship together, they also get to participate in small groups led by incredible adult volunteers who are loving and investing in them every single week. And of course, they get lots of hang time with their friends. We consider it such a privilege to walk with our families through every season and stage of their lives. From Pastor Kim Rogers in the nursery to Pastor Allison White in early childhood, Pastor Gabby Behrens in elementary, and Pastor Corey Hooper in preteen ministries, each of our pastors and their volunteers are committed to creating an environment where first our kids feel like they can belong. And then it's our hope that they'll believe in Jesus and surrender to his will for their lives, become disciples of him, all in preparation to be sent into this world as salt and light. There is incredible ministry happening on the second floor at BFC. This is the rec room of our Family Life Center. During the week, our after-school program meets in here. But on Wednesday nights, this is where our middle school and high school students come to hang out with friends, play games, and eat snacks before they head into our Wednesday night service. In our services, they're getting to participate in worship led by our student ministries worship leader, Jolie Nance. And then they hear a message from one of our student ministries pastors, and then they join together in small groups led by awesome adult volunteers investing in them week after week. Our student ministries team is led by Pastor Neil Stanglin, who just joined us earlier this year. He works alongside Pastor Ben Bumpus in connecting with our high school and middle school students, and with Pastor Ashley Lauder, who serves as our pastor of discipleship and curriculum and leads our after-school program. If you know of a 7th through 12th grader who's looking for a place to belong, we would love to connect with them and help them find their place in BFC student ministries. Not only is this space used for our after-school program and our family ministries team, every Wednesday night, our college students, led by our interim college pastor, Tiffany Hazel, join together in this space for late-night worship, community building, and best of all, free food. Everything you've seen today is made possible by your generous giving. Even if you don't have a kid in family ministries and you don't feel called to serve in family ministries, you can help young people come to know Jesus and become more like him by continuing to faithfully give. Before we go, I want to remind you that October is Pastor Appreciation Month. The family ministries pastors are a part of a larger team of pastors who lead us so well. If you've been blessed by the ministry of any of our pastors, I'd invite you to join me in helping them feel loved and appreciated this month. There are blank note cards in the main lobby that you can write them a personal note, or you can find your own special way to say thanks. We hope you've enjoyed going behind the scenes with us over the last 4 weeks and getting a small glimpse into life at BFC. A special thanks to Camden Goff, our digital media developer, for his production work. Today is our final sermon in our series, Enemies of the Soul. Over the last few weeks, we've learned about the first two enemies, the devil and the flesh. Today, Pastor Rick is here to talk with us about our final enemy, the world. It's no secret we live in a broken world where society's values often take the place of God's word. As followers of Jesus, we are called to honor God with the way we live and resist the influence of the world. But is that even possible? If so, where do we begin? I think you'll be encouraged today as we hear from Pastor Rick in our final sermon on enemies of the soul.
So this morning, I want to dive into the scripture with you, okay? And what I would love to do is I put 1 John chapter 2, verses 15 through 17 on the screen. I would love for you to read the first line with me in unison, the first sentence, okay? So back straight, voices clear, we're ready. We're all going to read together the first sentence. Do not love the world or anything in the world. So you might say, John, why are you challenging us not to love the world? He says, if anyone loves the world, well, love for the Father is not in them. It feels like to me saying you can't love God and love the world at the same time. It's not possible. Well, would you kind of flesh that out a bit? He says, okay, everything in the world, and you need to pay close attention because there is going to be a quiz, okay? The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life comes not from the Father, but from the world. You with me? He says there's three things that don't come from the Father. They come from the world, and that is the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. And then he concludes by saying, the world and its desires pass away. All of this stuff is fleeting. But whoever does the will of God, that person's going to live forever. So you ready for the quiz? Here we go. What comes from the world? Three things. The lust of the, and the, man, you guys are great. Yeah, you're good. When I was a young man and far from God, God came all the way to where I was. His arms were open. I felt his love. And he offered me something pretty powerful. He offered to forgive me of my sins. And I wanted God in my life. I wanted to be forgiven. I wanted to be right with God desperately. But here's what I came to realize. If I was going to hold on to God, I had to let go of the world. Are you hearing me? If I was going to hold on to God, I had to let go of the world. So this is Family Worship Sunday. We got lots of kids in the room this morning. We have a little girl named Draper, and Draper's going to jump up right now and run up here onto the platform as fast as she can, okay? And while she's coming, I want us to give all the kids a big hand for worshiping with us this morning. Can we do that? Hey, Draper, it's okay to run. Okay, there we go. How are we doing? How old are you?
Six.
6 years old. You're a little smaller than what I thought. I think we're going to be okay, though, okay? So I know this is going to be kind of heavy, but would you maybe pick that up for me? And it is. It's heavy, I promise you. But would you just hold it for me in your hands? Yeah, it's heavy, I know. It is, yeah. Draper, do you ever feel like you're carrying the weight of the world? Yes, I know what you mean. In first service, the little boy kind of did this a couple of times to show off. What do you think? Not going to happen. Okay, that's good. All right, so there you are. And so the reason I'm having you hold this, and I know it's heavy, is because it kind of represents the world as we're going to talk about it today, okay? What I want you to do, though, now is see that cross right over there? I want you to hold that cross like you're holding the world. Would you do that for me? Okay, that's great. Thank you so much. Yeah, go ahead. Pick up the cross. Yep. Okay, you're good. That's too heavy. I know. I'm sorry. All right, can you hold the cross? Is that better? Lighter? That's good, Draper. The cross is lighter than the world to carry. Okay, so you can set it back down, okay? All right, you did good. So just so that we can make the point, all right, just one more time. Would you just hold the world in your hands? Okay, hold on to the world, rather. Okay, you can set it down because I know it's heavy. And pick up the cross for me, would you? All right, go ahead. Now, Draper, you're only six. You can put it down. Come over here with me, okay? So you're only six, right?
Yes.
But you got a lot to sort out as you grow up, okay? And you're going to find in your life, Draper, that if you want to hold on to some things, you got to let go of some other things, all right? Okay. And so I watched you just now let go of the world so you could hold on to God, right? And you want to do that all your life. Would you like a prize for helping me today? Do you like candy? You do? Okay. So I'm going to give you some candy, and they're going to give you a big hand for helping out today, okay? All right, here we go. Thank you. So if you look me in the eye right now, which I'm hoping you will do, I want to ask you a question, and it's personal. Not asking the person beside you, behind you, in front of you, I'm asking you. I'm talking to you right now. You ready for this? Do you love the world? You might come back and say, well, God does. Most famous verse in the Bible, John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world, right? So I think we have to sort out the language today. So when I think about the world or the cosmos in Greek, as it's used in the New Testament, we do find John 3:16 that says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son. He's talking about humanity. So in that context, the way the New Testament uses the word cosmos, that we translate world, refers to humanity. Now, the word, like we use words differently, is used differently throughout the New Testament. So there's another example. Paul says, since the creation of the world, and he's talking about the mountains and the oceans and the stars in the sky and the planets and the sky and everything else. When he uses it that way, Paul's talking about the universe, okay? So when we talk about world in the Bible, we're either talking about humanity, God so loved the world. We're talking about universe when God created the world. But in our text today, you remember, John says, don't love the world. Whatever you do, do not love the world. When he uses it that way, we're talking about that which is in opposition to God. That which goes against what God wants for us. That which opposes God's will. In fact, let me give you a definition of world, okay? I think this is a pretty good definition. It's the entire system of rebellion against God and his rule for my life. It's the entire system of rebellion against God and his rule. And so we've been saying things in unison, so I think maybe just to make sure we're all together, What is the scripture teaching us today? And here's what the scripture teaches. Read with me in unison one more time. Back straight, voices clear. Here we go. Do not love the world. I'm amazed at technology these days. I'm just amazed. I'm amazed at how much information that we have that's available to us. I'm amazed how smart people are. I talked to a guy the other day who said, my son is doing cutting edge technology with his company and they're paying him crazy money to do what he's doing. When I think about how much we've advanced as a society and how much we know and how much information is available and what technology can do for us, I'm also very aware that sometimes you walk into church on a Sunday and a pretty little girl named Draper bounces up onto the platform and she lets go of the world so she can hold on to God. And truth becomes really clear and simple. And you hear the words of an old man now whose name is John, who's overseeing a network of house churches around Ephesus. And his heart has broken because some people in his churches have walked away from the faith because, in his words, they now have the viewpoint of the world. And you can hear him say again, as his words echo down through history, if anyone loves the world, love for the Father is not in them. So somebody's saying, you're sitting down, Rick, let's pretend you're in your office and I'm sitting in another chair in your office and you and I are just having this conversation with each other. And I'm just going to say to you, Pastor Rick, don't you think it's possible for somebody to love God, but also love the things that are so opposed to God? Don't you think somebody can hold on to some stuff in the world, hold on to some sin, and still love God? What do you think Paul really meant when he said, or John really meant when he said, if anyone loves the world, the love of the Father just isn't in them. You can't love both. And then I got a feeling there's a few hundred people looking at me right now saying, no, I get it. When I love the world, it crowds out my love for God. And when I've held on to those things that I knew God didn't want me to do, those things God said was sin, it created distance between me and God. You don't have any more convincing to do, Pastor Rick. I've experienced it in my own life. Sin separates me from God. So, I tell you often that I was raised in a small Kentucky town. And I'm very proud of that fact, regardless of the fact that I was not here last Sunday to defend myself when Pastor Brent Hardesty said that Ohio is where he's from and it's above Kentucky in many ways. Okay? But I am still a proud Kentuckian. The bluegrass state, the great commonwealth of Kentucky will always be my home. I grew up very aware of the people in Ohio, though, Pastor Brent, wherever you are sitting here in front of me, and the Buckeyes. I asked my dad once, what is a Buckeye? And he said, son, that's a worthless nut. I'm just quoting my dad is all I'm doing here. Did you know that Buckeyes are actually poisonous? And according to the internet, they can cause, if you get a Buckeye, you ingest, symptoms would be physical weakness, diarrhea, vomiting, paralysis, and in some cases, death. So you want to avoid the Buckeyes. I love my friend Brent a ton. Yeah. Growing up in that little town, attending a small Nazarene church there, there was a word that I heard often, and I didn't really love the word, I'll be honest with you. It was a word that my family used, my mom, my dad, even my pastor at church, maybe a Sunday school teacher at church, to help guide my life along the right path. And sometimes I would ask my parents, can I go do this? Or can we watch this on television? Or can we do that? And they would say no. And I would say why? And they would say because. And here's the word. It's worldly. Now, I don't know if there's anybody as old as I am in the room at this point, but anybody else ever had that word used on you? Okay, I got a few with me, okay? We don't use the word a lot these days, but I didn't love the word. No, Ricky, you can't do it. It's worldly. It's of the world. They did a good job of telling me I couldn't do stuff. They did not do a good job of defining the word worldly, though. But Paul does not make that, or rather, John does not make that mistake when he gives us these few verses. And so here's what he says. He says, let's talk about things that are from the world. Number one, he said, lust of the flesh. Now, let me break it down for you. Lust is an intense desire. Can I get a witness in the house this morning? Got a few brave souls. An intense desire that is also misplaced, okay, or disordered. Meaning, God has already said, no, that's not good for you. The flesh refers to sinful humanity, the state of human beings after the fall into sin. So I know that when we talk about lust of the flesh, our minds automatically go to sensuality, right? Sexual temptation, sexual desire. But it really can refer to anything that brings about physical pleasure or instant gratification. Now, this is Family Worship Sunday. We have kids in the room, and I'm talking about the lust of the flesh, and that's all I'm going to say about that. All right? Number two, he says, let me define the things that are of the world. It's the lust of the eyes. Our eyes are a gateway to our appetites and our desires. It's why it is so important that we guard our eyes. It's why it's so important that I guard my eyes. We're talking about sensory stimulation. It's pleasing, it's attractive, it's appealing. I saw it with my eyes. I desire it. Again, it's a misordered desire or misplaced. God has given us lots of appetites and desires that are good and healthy. It's when God says no that it becomes misplaced and disordered. Once in a while, somebody will run by the office on the third floor while I'm at work early one morning, or there'll be an email that says, donuts in the break room, help yourself. My immediate response is, I'm not eating a donut. I'm eating better right now. I can say no to donuts. That's not that big of a deal. 10 minutes later, I'm wondering what kind of donuts they have in the break room, you know? And maybe 20 minutes later, I've decided I'm going to go to the break room, but not for a donut, just for more coffee. I'm going to look at the donuts. Looking at donuts can be fun. And then I find myself in the break room looking at the donut, and I get a knife and I cut one in half. I'm not going to eat a whole donut. Lord help us. I'm not that weak. I'm going to eat half a donut. And then before I know it, I've eaten the other half. I don't want a whole. I just want two halves. You know where I messed up? Looking at that stupid donut. And so Paul says, if you want to know what's from the world, it's the lust of the flesh. It's the lust of the eyes. It's really important that you guard what your eyes see. The third thing he said is the pride of life. And when he says the pride of life, he's talking about accomplishments, achievements, money, possessions, status, that which I will say of myself, I am outranking, I am outshining somebody else, or this is what I've accomplished on my own doing. I did it my way. Look at me. Now, let me show you what it looks like in real life, okay? Genesis chapter 3, verse 6. Go back to the Garden of Eden. When the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food, lust of the flesh, You say, what are you saying? I shouldn't want good food? No, no, no. God had already said, don't eat that food. Right? You can eat all the other food you want. Just enjoy the food, but don't eat that food. So it's a misplaced desire. It's a disordered desire. And she saw it was pleasing to the eye, the lust of the eyes. You got the lust of the flesh. You got the lust of the eyes. And also desirable for gaining wisdom. I could become pretty impressive. The pride of life. She took some. She ate it. She gave some to her husband, who was also with her, and he ate it. That's what it looks like in everyday life. And here's what John says. He says all those things, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life. He said everything in the world comes not from the Father, but from the world. This is not what God wants for you. This is not what God's putting in front of you. This is not what God desires for you. This is what the world is putting in front of you. So I know that I'm looking at a room full of people who, you know, you want to do right. Some of the best people that I know in the whole world are sitting in front of me this morning. I'm impressed with your walk with God. And you're looking at me saying, Rick, I'm not going looking for worldly stuff. I'm not out there, you know, looking to give in to these desires. I know. But in this sermon series over these last 4 weeks, we said, you have an enemy of your soul. And the enemies of your soul is putting this stuff in front of you every day of your life. And I challenge you with the words from the scripture, like the Apostle Paul when he said, so don't be conformed to the patterns of this world. Don't do it. Or when Jesus says, you're in the world, but you're not of the world. I went home to my home in Kentucky to see my mom last week when we were on a little road trip. And my mom is 88. And she doesn't walk great. She uses a walker. She doesn't see great. She has macular degeneration, but she's the most positive, thankful person you'll ever meet in your life. Sitting there the other day, and I handed my phone to my wife, Annette, and I said, hey, take a picture of me and Mom. And I brought it with me, and I wanted to show you because I'm so proud of her. She's just the most precious, sweet woman you'll ever meet in your life. She is so much like Jesus. Mom taught me a lot of lessons in life. But here's one that I value greatly. She said, Ricky, when the Bible calls us to something, to do something, or to live a certain way, you can look at that two different ways. You can see that as a command that God is laying on you. This is something you got to obey. This is something you got to do. You know, okay, I guess I got to do this too now. I got to try to muster up the strength to try to live this way now. She said, you can see it that way. Or she said, you can view it as an invitation to the best life that anybody could ever possibly live. Because if God is asking you to do something, it's for your good and for His glory. And there is no better life than the life that God would call you to. So when we see in the Bible that God is calling us to a life, we can say, okay, I guess I gotta figure out how to do this now. I gotta, you know, walk a straighter line than I'm trying to walk now, I guess. Or you can say, God is inviting me with His arms open to the best possible life that anybody in the world could ever live, and I'm going to walk into that life with Him. So we've said don't a whole bunch today, right? Don't love the world. What are you supposed to do? And here's the do. Read it with me in unison again. Do the will of God. Paul says the world and all these desires, they're passing away. They're not going to be around. But the person who does the will of God, they're going to live forever. I'm offering you life that never stops. I'm offering you life that's abundant and full. I'm offering you the best life possible. I need to sit down one more time and then I'm going to stop, okay? What if somebody in front of me is saying, Rick, what if today, I'm just being honest with you, and I say to you, Pastor Rick, what if I love the wrong things? I know I shouldn't love them, but I do. I know I shouldn't want it, but I want it. I know I shouldn't desire it, but I desire it. I love things I shouldn't love. What do you got for me? I got good stuff for you. Number one, God loves you. And he wants to help you. God loves you and he wants to help you. Number two, if you say I've been doing the wrong things, what do we do about that? John says earlier in the same little letter, 1 John 1:9, he says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. That's good news, isn't it? If you say, I love the wrong things, in fact, I've been doing the wrong things, what about me? God loves you. He wants to help you. And here's a promise in his word. If you'll confess those sins, he's faithful, he's just, he'll forgive you, and he'll purify you from all unrighteousness. He says later in chapter 5, everyone who has been born of God overcomes the world. You don't have to live under it. You can live above it. And then he's given us practices that keeps our hearts turned toward him. We talk about practices all the time, right? They recalibrate our heart. They're means of grace. God does something in us. He changes us. He keeps us turned toward God when we worship together like we are now, when we're spending one-on-one time with God in his word and in morning prayer. Do you know it's really hard to get up and pray in the morning and say, oh, God, I just want to talk to you a while when the day before you've been sinning? All he wants to talk about is the day before. When you make yourself accountable to others in group life, that's why we encourage everybody to get in a group. When you find places to serve, when you find ways to give, when you find ways to share your faith with others, when you've got other people following you on this journey with Jesus, it motivates me to step it up. Well, Rick, all sounds good, but I need grace. I need help. Well, we have help for you this morning. It's not a pill that you take that makes everything else go away and you wash it down, but it is a moment of receiving God's grace in your life. Why would not you receive it every time you can? And that means that I'm believing that something happens in this moment in our hearts. If we sincerely come to Jesus saying, I'm accepting your love, I'm accepting your forgiveness, I'm accepting your help. And so this morning, I'm offering you life. God's grace poured out on you. And so if you will open the bread, if you are sincerely seeking Jesus, I invite you to join us in this. If you say, it's not where I am, then I would say, don't feel pressure to participate. But if you truly need God's grace today and your heart is open to it, then open the bread with me. And in a moment, we will eat it together. When he was with the disciples, he broke the bread and he said, this is my body broken for you. Take it, eat it, all of you. And then he took the cup and he said, this is my blood of the new covenant poured out for the forgiveness of sins of many. Drink it, all of you. Lord, we're all here together and we all have our own stories. There's somebody who wants to hold on to you. And they know they need to let go of the world. They want to hold on to you, God. But they know they need to let go of the world. Give them the grace. There are others who have let go of the world a long time ago, but in this moment they are reaffirming their faith and their commitment to you. So hear the prayer of all of us today. And let us sing together. You can have all of this world, but give me Jesus.
When I rise in the morning, when I rise in the morning, when I rise, give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. You can have all this world. Give me Jesus. And when I am alone, oh, when I am alone, oh, when I
I think we are good to celebrate one more baptism this morning. Do you agree with that, that we're good? So coming into the water is Beth Mankin. And Beth says, Jesus has helped me a lot in my life. I'm doing this today, getting baptized, because I know Jesus is working in me. And I'm doing this to thank him for what he's doing in my life. And so, Beth, we're really proud of you this morning, and we baptize you in this moment in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. I think we can really celebrate well with Beth. Can we do that? Beth, receive the grace and the healing of our Lord Jesus Christ, and may you be a faithful witness of Jesus. Amen. God bless you. Have a great day.